Penguin Random House Audio presents The Sakura Obsession, the incredible story of the plant hunter who saved Japan's cherry blossoms, by Naoko Abe. Read for you by Ellen Archer with Nicholas Guy Smith. Let me die underneath the blossoms in the spring, around the day of the full moon. Saigyo, 1118 to 1190. Prologue. A stone's throw from the western moat of the Imperial Palace in Tokyo, a future King of England thrust a shiny new shovel into the loamy soil. Peering at the thin trunk of the young cherry tree he had just planted in the British Embassy compound, Prince William smiled at his entourage. The tree planting ceremony in late February 2015 was just another ritual for the 32-year-old prince on his first visit to Japan, hours after meeting Emperor Akihito and Empress Michiko in their sequestered quarters within the moat. Unusually, the star of this occasion was the tree itself. This 10-foot-tall plant was no ordinary variety of cherry tree. Taihaku, or Great White, was a rare and spectacular tree, lauded by purists for its large, single white flowers. At one time, Taihaku became extinct in Japan, and its unlikely revival in a nation where cherry trees are an omnipresent and enduring symbol was due to one man, an Englishman, no less, Collingwood Cherry Ingram. Introduction. Every major step of my life started with cherry blossoms, as it does for most Japanese people. Japan is a nation where, contrary to Western habit, many significant beginnings occur in April, when the school and government year start and companies welcome their new recruits. When I was beginning nursery school in the central Honshu city of Nagoya in April 1962, a friend took a black and white photograph of me with my mother, Akiko, underneath the gossamer-thin pink petals of a single cherry tree near the school gates. Everyone did the same thing. Everyone. Not to have taken a photograph would have been almost sacrilegious. In the picture, I'm clinging on to my mama's arm, anxious about the day ahead, but comforted by the umbrella of flowers overhead. My father, Hiroyoshi, wasn't in the photo. As a journalist, he was working, always working, writing stories about the corporate businessmen driving Japan's reemergence as a post-war industrial power. In 1964, the newspaper for which my father worked transferred him to Tokyo, and we left our wooden tatami-floored home in Nagoya aboard one of the first bullet trains to the nation's capital. Tokyo was about to host its first Olympic Games, the nation's proudest moment in decades. It was proof that Japan was back on its feet after the humiliating devastation of defeat and nuclear destruction. At the Takamatsu Primary School, where I enrolled that spring, Mama and I once again stood under the cherry blossoms at the school entrance for the obligatory photograph. Junior high school, high school, university. For us, it's always the same. April represents a fresh start, another step in life. The cherry blossoms. The photos. And here I am again in April 1981, captured under fully opened blossoms by the family Canon camera on the day that I became a professional journalist. Japan's attachment to cherry blossoms represents a unique and singular obsession. We're a homogeneous people. 98% of the 127 million population are ethnically Japanese, linked by more than 2,000 years of tradition and a cultural affinity to one plant. Other nations have special flowers, of course, but who could imagine virtually the entire population of Britain or Germany or America visiting parks on one particular weekend to view a flower, no matter how lovely? At the newspaper where I worked in Tokyo, covering the Prime Minister's office and, later, the Ministry of Defense, we would send a young assistant to a nearby park next to the Imperial Palace, laden with plastic sheets and cardboard. There, he would spread these mats under a cherry tree and sit shoeless all afternoon, woe betide anyone wearing shoes on our plastic carpet, to defend our space, in readiness for the evening's hanami, or cherry viewing party. In Japanese, hana means flower and mi means seeing. Hanami was an annual rite of spring, a communal orgy of cherry blossom-flavored rice, pickles, wine, sake, and sweets, loud singing, corporate bonding, and reunions of friends and family. All my life, I had taken the blossoms for granted. What I never considered was why most of the planted trees growing in urban Japan, 7 out of every 10 specimens, were of the same variety, known as Some Yoshino. When I moved to London in 2001, I was puzzled by the varied cherry blossom landscape throughout the British Isles. The blooms I encountered here were multicolored, white, pink, reddish, some even greenish, and the trees blossomed at different times, usually from mid-March until mid-May. Some of these trees burst into flower, dropped their petals, and then another variety would take over, producing a kaleidoscopic cascade effect of blossom that stretched the cherry season to 2 months. In Japan, the season is much more defined. The flowers of each Some Yoshino tree survive for about 8 days, no more. And the reason they all blossom together and then lose those blossoms together is that they are clones. And so the Sakura, or cherry blossom culture, of the 20th and 21st centuries revolved around the flower's short life and swift, predictable death. The cherry blossom was ephemeral, like life itself. What on earth had happened, I found myself wondering, to the wild cherries, such as Yamazakura, that grew en masse in the mountains or were planted in the cities during the samurai era in the 17th and 18th centuries? What happened to varieties cultivated in abundance for hundreds of years by the daimyo, the feudal lords who ruled principalities all over Japan, and by cherry aficionados in the ancient city of Kyoto? What indeed had happened to the once prized diversity of the cherry trees, with their wonderfully varied and different flower forms? Researching a newspaper column about how cherry trees spread in the British Isles, I came across the story of Collingwood Ingram, whose crusade to preserve Taihaku and scores of other Japanese cherry tree varieties is legendary among Western horticulturalists. To the Japanese and the wider world, it is unknown. As I investigated further, Ingram's name kept popping up, and soon I found myself caught up in a full-scale journey of discovery about the cherry tree, which took me to archives, botanical gardens, horticultural research institutes, and temples throughout Japan and the United Kingdom. Along the way, the quest became deeply personal, upending views that I had held since birth about a tree I thought I knew intimately. In the course of my research, I read about a visit that the Kent Gardens Association had made in May 2010 to The Grange, a 25-room house in the village of Benenden, which, in 1919, had been bought by Ingram and his wife Florence. The guest speaker on that visit was Charlotte Molesworth, a topiary specialist who lived in a cottage next to The Grange with her gardener husband Donald. Charlotte and Donald knew the Ingram family well, and she suggested that I should contact Ernest Pollard, Ingram's gentlemanly grandson-in-law. In turn, Pollard invited me to his home near the East Sussex town of Rye. His wife, Varian, is Ingram's granddaughter. There, on a round wooden table in a tidy ground floor office, the Pollards had laid out piles of diaries, sketches, handwritten memos, research papers, books, journals, photographs, and newspaper articles. To my joy, I had stumbled across a treasure trove spanning Collingwood Ingram's 100-year life from 1880 to 1981. Apart from Ernie, as he insisted I call him, no one had looked at most of this valuable collection. Much of it had sat for years in cardboard boxes, before he started sorting out the material. Ernie kindly lent me copies of transcribed diaries that Ingram had written during his visits to Japan in 1902, 1907, and 1926. Back home in London, I checked the names of the people Ingram had met on his trips to Japan. They proved a revelation. They included.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.